If you're gonna run out of the house, you're gonna do it naked or on fire.
Huh? Look at me. Whee!
This week on Auto Restomod, Jeff and Cam finished the Streeter Track suspension with an NPD Street Bandit disc brake kit.
National Parts Depot is proud to offer this exclusive reproduction of the 1970 to 78 Camaro dash pad. Get one for your car and improve your ride. Check out National Parts Depot for Mustang and Cougar, Camaro and Firebird, Chevelle and GTO, Ford truck and Bronco, Chevy truck, Mopar, and Thunderbird. At our four locations, we stock the largest selection of classic car parts anywhere. Visit us at nationalpartsdepot.com or call us at 888-893-FAST.
Ooh, this is good.
I'm pulling it off and putting it on my car.
Oh, hell no.
This is just really pretty.
Yeah.
I don't know what the bad thing is. We got all this work done. We're going to be doing the brakes today. I figure we'll go ahead and get that out of the way. Most going to concentrate on tips and tricks.
Yeah.
But what I wanted to do is to talk about, you know, with the brake kit, these are some things you can run into with any brake kit that you buy.
Yeah. Literally.
Street Bandit stuff's got a good price point on it, got a few things I want to talk about. But the bad thing is this is setting up a cascade failure effect.
Yeah, because I already want to go in and replace the tie rods now.
You're going to do the tie rods.
Pump us maybe a 1-inch sway bar.
See, now you want another sway bar.
Rack and pinion.
You can do Coyote. The 302. You're just going all the way out the door then. Hey, if you're going to run out of the house.
It's got the suspension for it.
If you're going to run out of the house, you're going to do it naked or on fire. Yeah. Huh?
Look at me.
Whee! So basically now you want to just do the whole car because we got to do the frame rail. Because you're going to do that frame side. If we're going to do it, we're going to do the frame side. Because yeah. We already talked about it.
Do the whole thing, yeah.
Yeah, might as well. Just take it all apart.
Just another.
Let's buy another car. Let's buy one done.
Let's buy a diesel.
Oh, God. No. I don't even want to think about putting a Cummins in that thing or run. See, never mind. I'm not even going to go there because you're going to start thinking about it, and then you're going to want to do it. Anyway, let's go ahead and get started. I'm going to go and talk about the stuff on the table because I got a couple things I want to hit and go over that I like about this kit from National Parts Depot. And then we're going to go ahead and start slamming everything on here. But we do have a wonderful hurricane possibly coming our way. So we need to get all of our classics inside the garage. And we can't do that until we do this. Because this thing needs to be at least mobile and rollable, if not.
So mine's getting parked up.
Who cares? Well, see, what I'm hoping for is maybe a tree will fall on it and I can get the suspension off your car.
Yeah, if you knock me out with
you won't have a car.
Hell no.
He just doesn't have that certain je ne sais quoi he requires to just give me stuff that I want. So, stuff on the table. Now, we've kind of talked about this a little bit in recent episodes, but we're going to go over it a little bit more tightly today and kind of go over some of the things that I really like about this kit. The National Parts Depot kit is fairly complete. Comes with all the good stuff to put a disc brake kit on a car. Some of the things that I really like about this kit is one thing, these shields. A lot of brake kits that are cheaper than this, and even some of the more expensive ones that you can get out there, do not come with brake shields. And this can be nice for daily driving cars because it will keep a lot of the water and things off the discs. Granted, discs are not as prone to fading from water, but they can still float the pads up if you're not careful. These shields can help keep that from being an issue on the car. So I like having these shields. Next thing up I'm going to talk about are the calipers. Now these are basically the same calipers that were used on the 1965 and 6 Mustang, the Fairlane GT, anything that you got a disc brake kit on it, they used this 4-piston caliper. It is a 4-piston. It is a really nice 4-piston. Pads are pretty generous on it. This is not what I would call a road race system by any stretch of the imagination, but this is exactly the same brake system that Shelby used on the GT350 in 1965 and 1966 and up into 1967. 1968, they went to the single piston caliper. In my opinion, Shelby was just kind of like, yeah, write the check. Because it's A.O. Smith took over. It really wasn't built by Shelby anymore. Not going to get off into all that too much. The kit's really nice and complete. Everything you need to put it together. The only thing that I would probably say that you might want to do is look at doing a braided hose on this if you're going to do any hard driving on the car rather than using the rubber hose that they're using with the kit. It's just an upgrade. If you're going to be street driving the car, quite honestly, this piece right here will do you everything you need to do when you're on the street. Now, I'm going to talk about the rotors for just a second. The rotors come with the races already installed and ready to go. It also comes with another set of bearings and races. Now, the races that are in here are Temkin races. Looks like a really good system on here, but they're including these, and these are both by PTC. I don't know if you want to take the races out of here to put these with them so that you have a match set of races and bearings. Some people might want to do that. I'm kind of going to think about gambling with the Temkins that we got here and these bearings. We might even decide at some point to go and upgrade so that we have a full set of Temkins where we have the bearings that are Temkin bearings for in here and not use the stuff made in China. I don't think there's really any problem with this, but they're sending this, so my thought process is that you might want to go in and change these out to make sure that you've got a matched set of bearings and races. Everything else on the table pretty much explains itself. I'm going to talk about the dual reservoir master cylinder now, and that's something that a lot of guys should really consider in a car that they're going to be driving fairly frequently. If you're doing a concours type car, that is to say a trailer delivered to the show, you're not going to be driving it, you can stay with a single fruit bowl master cylinder on the car. Even so, if you're going to be doing that, you need to upgrade the reservoir to the larger disc brake reservoir and don't stay with the drum brake reservoir that was on them from the factory. The cool thing about this kit from National Parts Depot is the fact that it comes with the lines now to install this on the system. Before, it did not have that, and you had to go in and bend your lines and make everything yourself. This speed things up. The only thing I will say is it'd be nice if somebody would make, and they may, a set of lines for this kit that were in stainless. You can still take this and bend your own if you wanted to. It's really not that complicated. These bends aren't anything spectacular or hard. You can go in and do that and make it right as rain. Comes with a rear proportioning valve, which is really nice to already have in the kit. Easy to set up and put in line on your stuff. So that's something else that's this part of this that I really like. Basically, that's all of our parts. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to start doing some little tips and tricks on installation on this stuff. We're going to go through some of the things that you can run into when putting the disc brakes in the car. We're not going to do an absolute blow-by-blow. There are tons of videos out there on how to do these disc brakes. We've actually done one a while back. The link for that video is here. We've also done a video on how to bleed down one of these dual reservoir master cylinders in preparation for putting it in the car. The URL for that is down here. And both of those URLs are also down in the About section on the video, underneath the video right below me here. Well, not below me, but from your perspective below me. Anyway, so we're going to go ahead and get going on this. Cam's going to start talking about putting everything on the car, and I'm going to go back off and probably hack and cough because I am still dealing with that cold.
All right, now the first tip I'm going to give you is about the caliper mount brackets. They mount with the round side facing up and the standoffs facing back. The standoffs also go towards the front of the vehicle. Now, also when you do this, you're going to mount your dust shield mounts on top of the bracket. Take your bolts, run them through. It's easier if you start off with two of them. Slide it in, start two of your serrated flange nuts on the back side. Now you've got three short bolts and one long bolt. Long bolt goes on the side of the pitman arm because it runs through the pitman arm. Throw your nuts on, tighten them down. All right, so the next up is doing the wheel bearings. I have some wheel bearing grease here. It's for disc and drum. Make sure you get the disc brake because they build more heat into the hub. So you need grease that is compatible for it. So I'm gonna do the old hand pack. There are packers that you just use a grease gun. I prefer packing them by hand. And this is one of the few times you will see me using gloves because this stuff stinks. Do not want to be smelling it for the rest of the day. And mind you, this is a very messy procedure. You will have grease everywhere by the end of it. Now when I pack bearings, I normally just run it through. I run it through the grease, catching the outer cone, until I see grease coming up in between the rollers. And then move a little bit further on until you go all the way around and you have grease all over your hands. All right, spread some in. Make sure it's packed real good. I'm gonna go ahead and do both of them. All right, I'm gonna try and wipe some of the grease off my hands so I don't spread grease onto everything in this shop. All right, pick the hub up. Try not to touch the braking surface. Put the inner bearing in. As we said before, these are the right races that ship with it. I already drove them out to double check they are the same part number. Now when you take your grease seal, You want to do a little dab all around in the V so that seal is lubricated. Slide it down into the hub. Use a smooth face hammer and just tap the outside. You'll hear a pitch change when it hits the bottom of the hub. And it just popped back out. All right, now that's in. Flip it over. Take a good finger grease, slather the inside of the hub. I like to overpack bearings. More lube, the better. I'd much rather have too much lube than not enough. Slide the hub on. Once you feel it seated, slide your outer bearing onto the spindle. And go ahead and take the gloves off. Okay, now for the nut. Ah. Thank you. Put the washer on, your castellated nut. All right, now I have an adjustable wrench. I'm going to use that to seat the bearings, spin in the hub, tighten them down. It's pretty much a feel-as-you-go procedure, in my opinion. Yeah, that's fully seated. They're good and tight. Now I back off half turn, spin it, tighten it by hand. Once you can't go any further with your fingers, go a little bit past with a wrench. Since these are new bearings, they will break in, and that will give them end play. All right, take a cotter pin. Need a little bit more. There you go. Your hub spins freely. Might seem like it stops too soon, but once you get the weight of the tire and the wheel on there, it'll spin freely. Your bearings are installed and adjusted. You spin me around. All right, now that we have the bearings on and adjusted, I'm going to clean off the braking surface because I got some grease on it. You're supposed to use brake clean. We are out, so I'm just going to use acetone. Wipe it down until I get a mostly clean rag. After that, it's all good. All right, so the next thing on is the caliper. The brake line that goes between the pistons goes on top, and the bleeder screw goes on top. So they are side specific, but if you mix them up, that's how you can determine. So, slide it over the rotor. Throw your two bolts in it. And go ahead and tighten those down. Just going to use a ratcheting wrench to make this easy and quick. Alright, now that one's in. Yay, it doesn't touch. The caliper is slightly off-center, but the pad isn't touching. The other side we did have to shim, but this side might be able to get away without doing that. If you need to, what we did was just put a thin washer in between the caliper and the caliper mounting bracket and moves the caliper in towards the inner fender. So that is how we cleared that gap up. All right, next up is your brake line. Do not forget this copper washer in between the caliper and the line. It's what seals the line to the caliper. You're going to put the rubber brake line on. They send with it brass fittings that convert from different diameter brake lines. I'm going to check. I don't believe this one needs it. Nope, that fits like a hot dog down a hallway. So we do not need the brass that came with it, so I'm just going to install it straight on. Install the clip. use my tapping wrench, install the clip. Now the really fun part of getting this brake line fitting the thread in. Now, as little torque you're putting on it, it's always good to use line wrenches on fittings. So that way you do not splay the wrench and strip them, because then you'll have to cut the line, make new lines. That's a long, drawn-out process. All right, fittings threaded in. You run it down, snug it up. All right, so the last thing to do on the hubs is install the dust cap. Driver's side was a real pain. This side, hopefully, is not going to be that bad. I'm gonna try to center it as best you can. Use either a soft face or a leather face hammer. It's gonna start doing that. So what I like to do is use a screwdriver, get on the edge that it's popped out on, ease it in, and it pops right back out. This is one of those that you're just gonna have to work it all the way around and probably end up screaming a few times. Now, what you can also use is a piece of PVC that goes over the cap and fits on that outer lip. You can also use a socket if you have one that large, and it just lets you put force on all sides at once.
All right, while Cam's off getting a couple things finished up for the other side of the car, I wanted to talk about a point of order on the shields here. The shields actually can have a problem, and almost every one of them I have ever done on this type of brake system, that can have a contact problem with the shield and the caliper. You're almost always, as far as I've seen, going to have to trim this back just a little bit to get it to clearance the shield, possibly top and bottom. I would go ahead and do it, assemble everything, then go in and pull the caliper off and just use a Dremel tool to go in and take and pull a clearance out of that. Because I've not built one yet, and I've done five or six of these, that you don't have to do some kind of clearance work either on one end of it or the other. So just keep that in mind too. That's another little tech tip for the brake kit like this. Make sure you get that clearance, because if you don't, it can cause some vibration issues on the front end of the car whenever you're doing hard braking. And if the calipers start to vibrate, they're going to vibrate up against this, and you're going to get a weird wailing noise from the front end, which you don't want. So, take care of that, and then basically we're about done. Let's put the wheel on here and see what we got. Ooh. Yeah, I know, right? They look pretty good. The magnets are cleaning up a little bit. I got to go and do something with the centers on them so it'll match the... I should just leave them alone. Yeah. I was going to say if it'll match the patina of the car, but...
Yeah, you just... I know someone said it earlier, but I honestly am agreeing with them, thinking about leaving the fenders off for a little bit.
No! No!
Got to show it off.
We've shown it off for like 4 weeks now, because we showed it off whenever we were doing the you know, how to figure out if you got problems in the shock towers, which we did. Then we showed it off a little bit when we were doing the other stuff. And then finally now we've got it installed. Now we do need to go in and obviously on the strut do our final adjustments once we get it on the ground and know where it sits.
Sit right
and you need to have the fenders on to do that. So you need to know what your wheel clearance is. I'm worried these aren't going to work. I don't want to do the men where men will make it fit thing with them. I'm a little worried if the 235-60s are going to work. Mm-hmm. We're going to try it anyway. We're going to see if we can make this happen. But this is you know,
it's a pretty big
Tire package to put on here, and it's going to be a lot of strong arming to get it to turn around. We're going to probably do some stuff with caster to try to make that a little bit easier. We may try to go with a little less caster than what they're recommending, because originally these things had almost zero caster in them, which was how they made it where it was easier to do manual steering in a parking lot. So we probably will want to go in and muck about with that just a little bit. We're going to do another alignment video because we screwed the last one up.
Epically.
And so we're going to go back in and re-hit that and tap it again and then put that one in on top of the video that's already there so people will go to it instead. But I'm really happy with the way everything worked out.
Got to get shock tower braces.
We got to get the shock tower braces in here just to finalize that. Besides, right, like, you know, you're going to cover it up with the shock tower braces anyway. Might as well put the fenders on it.
Been riding around for a few years without those.
I don't know. No. So anyway, that's what we got left to do. I'm pretty much basically done with this. Brake bleeding and all that. We've done a video on brake bleeding. Mm-hmm. Again, that's going to be in the About section underneath the video. If you want to go take a look at how to bleed the brakes on a car, you can go and take a look at that video to show how to do that. And the other ones, like I said before, are going to be in there as well.
Yep.
I feel kind of bad. I mean, this is the 2 weeks that you've been doing this, and it's been almost no trouble at all. The 3 or 4 weeks that I was involved, maybe I should just quit and let you take over, and everything will be easy and roses, and I can sit down and collect the cash.
Yeah, no. No, that ain't going to happen.
Well, I am happy.
Oh, yeah. I'm happy. Let's get the alignment jigged out. I want to drive it.